everyone. My name is Alain Gennari. I'm from Parma, Italy. And today I will tell you about the coin of the so-called Sirmium group. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Gorsch and the Warsaw University for giving me the opportunity of being here today with you. And I apologize for my English, it's becoming really worse every day. I've always worked on 5th and 6th century coins, mainly on the late Roman, Byzantine and Romano barbaric lineage, and I'm the curator of the Byzantine and barbaric section of the most important Italian numismatic forum, lamoneta.it. Anyway, I will base my contribution on the second edition of my paper about the Sirmium group that I hope I'll be able to upload on academia.edu within June. The first edition is freely downloadable, and I know many of you download it. One way thing to the coins of the Sirmium group that some people call the GPs siliqua, but I prefer to call them the Sirmium group as Professor Metric did. I said one way thing to the coins of the Sirmium group, the first image that comes to our mind is that a coin like this. And this is not surprising because these coins that I call type 2 represents 70% of the world group in my database. But working on more than 500 coins, I was able to identify 9 different types that I'm going to illustrate briefly to you, and a great number of unrecorded monograms. Many of them are unrecorded before. Well, type 1 is a so-called quarter siliqua, with a reverse legend referred to the Victoria and not the Victor Roma, combined with the usual monogram of Theodoric the Great. This coin is always in the name of Anastasius, and the first one that you see at the top, first one, is represented in my database by 25 specimens from the same pair of dice. There are no different dice of this coin. In this coin, this one, please note that the obverse legend starts at 5 and can be read counterclockwise from the outside as in the Ostrogothic Italian issues. And so, in synthesis, type 1 includes coins with an obverse legend in the name of Anastasius, a reverse legend referring to victory, and the Theodoric monogram. Type 2, as I told you before, is the typical and more commonly called GPS siliqua, and 70% of the coins in my database are type 2. This issue is known in countless variations, but it is characterized by 3 fundamental traits. First one, the obverse legend always in the name of Anastasius. Second one, the reverse legend in Victa Roma, variously reported. And the Theodoric monogram on the reverse. Within this type 2, there are many, many variations in general style, monogram style, present or absence of a dotted circular red, general style of the burst, the legend, the type of the legend, and many other details. However, each coin has clearly shown the 3 fundamental traits characterizing type 2. The obverse legend in the name of Anastasius, the reverse legend referring to the Invicta Roma, and the Theodoric monogram on the reverse. Type 2 is in fact imitative of the Ostrogothic Italian coinage. In the coinage of Ostrogothic Italy, the so-called coi, Metric identifies some quarter siliqua with Anastasius on the reverse and Theodoric monogram on the reverse. In several small stylistic variations, these coins were issued in Ravenna, Milan, and Ticino, again. All these coins listed in the book have a complete reverse legend, apparently always correctly reported as Invicta Roma, although sometimes with different breaks. The coins of type 2 of the Sirmium group have some differences with this Italian prototype. For example, in the Sirmium group, there is always a second A in the reverse legend. So, Invicta A Roma, instead of Invicta Roma. In the Sirmium group, there are many different letters in the lower part that I would call Xer, but it's not an Xer. There are many different in the style of the occurs that the Italian coins are higher quality. In the Ostrogothic coin age, the obverse legend is often broken by the head of the emperor, while in the Sirmium group it is always unbroken. Type 3 are some, I call them unattributed and transitional style quarter silqua. This type 3 is an absolute exception within the 9 types, because even though the sample consists, in my database, only of 12 specimens, occupying 8 different numbers in my catalog, it includes coins struck in the name of Anastasius, Justinian I, and probably Justin I. The coin number 126 and 126B, the top, have an incredibly figurative reverse. The reverse is clearly linked in style to the Sirmium group, though not tie-linked to any other coin in my database. The reverse, included in a dot circular red, has no terms of comparison. It is the only figurative reverse in the Sirmium group. The first one, coin 126, in the name of Anastasius, appeared in a singular specimen in a Vecchi action in 1999. And the reverse can stimulate some comparison with many Concordia coins from the 4th and 5th century. For example, here is a Chaosium coin in the name of Theodosius II. But this prototype is obviously too old to be a real prototype for this simple imitation. The second one, this one, comes from a private collector and seems to be in the name of Justin I. This coin was probably found in Hungary. Then, thanks to Professor Hirsch, a new coin was shown to me. This one. And this one is in the name of Anastasius and has a beautiful reverse. This coin has the Justin coin number 136B, has some special features that, as some other coin in the Sirmium group, seems to refer to Christian symbols. István Vida of the National Hungarian Museum pointed my attention to some special features. The dove on the cross, that is the Holy Spirit. The circle of dots on the cross that might symbolize the crown of thorns of Jesus. And the man on the right, it may be Jesus himself, rising the end in the gesture of teaching. He is bigger than the other one, and the scene might also be the Dominus legend doctor, but it is less likely as it should be standing. I think it is not standing. We must consider that either under Gothic or Greek rule, Sirmium was a very important ecclesiastic center. The coin number 179, even if I put this coin on the section type 9, because of the very crude reverse and because of the reverse red style, this coin could be considered the last phase of type 3. Look at the altar, the cross, the red, and I thought maybe the crown of thorn and the two figures that now are two stellograms. One of those is Picular. These are all Christian symbols. The second group within type 3 have peculiar dialings. There are, for example, coins struck with a monogram and striking the name of Anastasius, coin with a monogram striking the name of Justinian I, and coins imitating the Italian coinage in the name of Atellari with the legend on the obverse, in the reverse of four lines. These coins are partially linked by dial identity in red, and partially linked by general style in green. Well, type 4, which reference is still the catalog Vecchi 14 of On the obverse, there is still the bust of Anastasius with a much bigger torso, perhaps thanks to the greater space available on this coin. The legend of the obverse is always broken and in some cases completely misunderstood and, I mean, barbarized. The reverse is really unique because we find here a legend variously referred to the Victoria. In Excel, a canon variously reported that nothing would have to do with a silver issue. And in the center of the field, between two horizontal bars, the letter SRN, with M sometimes replaced by W. SRN seems a direct reference to the Sirmium mint. And being on a coin that brings a Victoria legend on the reverse, it seems to establish an immediate connection with the type 1. Even if we consider the limited number of specimens and high variability of weights, the average weight of this type 4 is 1.54 grams, then exactly twice the weight of type 1. That is why for type 4 only we use the habitual modern term of siliqua, half and a quarter. Anyway, quarter siliqua, and siliqua is a modern term that for the siliqua coin was simply weight. We must remember that siliqua is a term that in ancient times does not identify the siliqua coin. Type 5 is similar to type 2, but it is in the name of Justin the First. Type 5 is the second most representative group, but it represents only more than 9% of the total database. Only 47 specimens, showing on the reverse the Invicta Roma with Justinian obverse. My type 6 is a quarter sleeve with the name of Justin the First, but with an epigraphic reverse. This type has a very limited number of specimens, but it is a very important type because of the links with the other types. In the reverse is shown for the first time the simplified monogram in which some authors read the name of Camus. But in fact, it is simply a Tuileries simplified monogram. In the monogram, for the first time in some cases, there is a star in various positions. You can see the star on the right. Type 7 is a quarter siliqua, still in Victor Roma, in the name of Justinian the First. Very, very similar to type 2, very similar to type 5. I have only 6 coins of this type within 500 coins of the same group. The type 7 shares its only obverse die, for me, O98, with type 8. Type 8 is a quarter siliqua in the name of Justinian the First, with an epigraphic reverse, like type 6 in the name of Justin the First. Only 12 specimens in my database. This coin are closely related to type 7, because of the O98 obverse die, as you can see in the picture. And closely related to the type 6, because the general style of the reverse. Here you can see this direct link between type 7 and type 8. Type 7, and from this one to type 8, this is a direct link. Type 9 is represented by quarter siliqua, often assigned to Cunimon, with an epigraphic reverse. As for type 3, we must divide this type 9 in two parts. In this slide, you can see two coins from the Berlin Museum, upper part. One coin was published by Metric, and one coin published by Alain and Han. And a new specimen found in Hungary. This one is a private collection. All these obverses are in the name of Justin. For some authors, Justin the Second, in my opinion, Justin the First. About the first one, Metric wrote, "This C, of course, can easily be interpreted as indication for Cunimont. name 6 is in the name of Justin I. The red on the reverse and the supposed Cunningham coin does not suggest a unique reading, because it is unbroken and unoriented, and offers many angles of reading. For example, the reverse turned upside down seems to show a star run. Very different from the period. In January 2016, I knew only the metric coin. And so, just one of the two Berlin coins. But in the last months, a check on the Berlin Museum allowed me to verify that the coins were actually two, almost identical, even from flan, but with microscopic difference in the star on the reverse. These are two different coins. But we even found it hard to believe that the coins were actually two different specimens, fearing that it was a mere mistake on the online catalog, but the Berlin Museum confirmed that these are two different but identical coins. The coins also have identical abrasion in wear, and that they have identical weights. And at this point they are forgeries, and so they are now quoted as forgery on the Berlin Museum. Falschen. That means forgery. That's my fault. And so, if the coin published by hand is not a forgery, and a good analysis from the picture is impossible to me, 2/3 of these coins are forgeries, and one of these reported by Matthew. The obverse link with my 097 die is most likely a result of a cast, specially prepared for the counterfeiting of these specimens. To further complicate the situation, it is already complex. In the autumn of 2016, a new coin was shown to me. Here you can see the obverse die 0996 with all the reverse linked directly. This coin was shown to me in autumn. This is number 178 in my catalog. There is a center cross. On each side of the cross, in this case, in place of the C and the star, there are some undefined broken lines. And this is another mistake to me. The second group within type 9 rises even bigger problem. The only coin known to me in the first edition was the coin number 175 in the catalog, and it was sold by NAC, the Numismatic Ars Classica, as a Cunningham coin, because of the C. This coin seemed to show once again a C on the reverse, and the obverse apparently once again in the name of Justin. I think Justin first. In this case, the red on the obverse apparently allows the correct orientation of the coin. The coin reoriented thanks to the red present a perfect symmetry between the central cross, the circle, the crosses and the stars on the side. The supposed C of Cunningham disappeared in favor of a semicircle that closes at the top the general design of the reverse. We therefore decided to maintain the type 9 in the catalog, but these coins must be considered in some ways like the type 3, something still not fully explained, that anyway we cannot assign for sure to Cunningham. I will talk again about this strange type at the end of this conversation. One of the major innovations of last month is represented for me by a coin recently appeared on the market that link type 1 and type 2. This one. This coin was sold by Numismatic Newman in Action 49. While on the reverse, clearly belongs to type 2, because on the reverse you can see Invicta Roma and not Victoria. The obverse die, 01, is the same of the type 1, coin number 1, whose reverse legend was Victoria. The obverse die, 01, that we can see on 25 specimens of type 1, with a progressive damaging and with a clear central break, here in this coin seems fresh and new. And the coin number 1, that was probably minted before Victoria coins. The surprises are not over, as This coin N1 is very, very similar, even if there is not a die identity, to the Ostrogothic coinage of Ravenna. Here you can see a Ravenna coin, the N1 that is type 2 because of Invicta Roma, and type 1, Invicta, this is Dali. This gives new elements for the dating and the sequence of types of the Sirmium group. The coin N1, for example, as the, for example, the metric coin 44A in the picture have the same 1 gram style, and every letter in the legend seems in the same position, as you can see. The obverse legend that starts at 5 and can be read anti-clockwise from outside is typical of Ravenna coinage and is shared by the coin with the reverse O1. This probably means that the first issue in Sirmium was made by the Ostrogoths, probably thanks to the engravers from Ravenna, and immediately after the coin N1, a new celebrative issue was made, the Victoria type. And then there was a return to the Invicta type, Roman type 2. Nowadays, this seems more than just a theory. The dating of the group is one of the focal points of the whole discussion, because it is strictly connected with the question, who coined the Sirmium group? In order to answer to this question, we must reflect and match the historical facts and the numismatic evidences. These coins are for more than 70% in the name Venestatius, and almost all reports a monogram variously assigned to Tilric. Tilric won the gibbet twice. And looking to the relationship between the gods and the gibbets during the reign of Tilric, it appears unlikely that the gibbets wished to put the monogram of the Gothic key on their coins, especially since Tilric took possession of Sirmium from the gibbets. On the world database, more than 70% of the coins are in the name of Anastasius, that died in 518. But some authors think that these coins were minted under the reign of Justinian I, when Anastasius was dead 6 years. This idea is not entirely without precedent. The Ostrogothic king Titigis, Totila, Baduila, and Tia, in fact, coined silver coin in the name of Anastasius, which was already dead. However, the fact happened during a major event, the Gothic War. The Ostrogoths, who had reached an agreement and some sort of stability under Anastasius, were attacked and invaded in Italy by the new emperor Justinian I. So they took him away from their coins, on which they always maintained the imperial reference, and they replaced him with the former emperor Anastasius. The fact is therefore theoretically possible, but if these coins were minted by non-Ostrogothic authority, the gibbets for example, there would be no reason to show the monogram of Theodoric that was already dead in 526. If the coins were minted by the gibbets, there is the absence of a motivation as strong as the Gothic War to justify this anti-imperial choice, and the absence of a motivation for the Theodoric monogram. Between Justinian I and the gibbets, there were erratic deals and many problems, but nothing like the invasion of the Desarius in Italy. Furthermore, there were many agreements, for example, between the death of Theodoric, which took place in August 526, and the arrival of the Desarius in Italy 535, the gibbet king Helmund had an agreement with Justinian I. The Emperor Justinian I considered Illyria an important base for the Gothic War. Now we need to review the compared timeline. The supposed gibbet minting in two separate moments, I mean before 505 and after 536, seems contradicted by numismatic evidence. While a gibbet coinage in the period from 536 to 567 only is lacking of evidences and gives no answer about the choice of a monetary type that was already obsolete, the Invicta Roma, in conjunction with a monogram of an old enemy, Theuderic. It seems clear that Theuderic was king until 526 when he died, and Sirmium, which he conquered in 504-505, remained for a decade after his death in Ostrogothic hands. Justinian I was emperor from August 527 and was associated with the throne with his uncle Justin I in April. If we try to assume that the Sirmium group was minted by the Ostrogoths instead of the Japanese, we have the king Theuderic, and in one specimen the name of Ethelric, remember type 3, together with the emperor present on the coins and the possession of the city of Sirmium in Ostrogothic hands. We must note that the Justinian I coins with Theuderic monogram are very, very rare. The Ostrogothic king died a few months before Justinian I's accession to the throne, and these coins were perhaps an attempt to maintain a style of the reverse that was accepted for years, if not perhaps a deliberate homage to Theuderic the Great. In any case, the minting was soon interrupted. Perhaps the Ostrogoths started minting in Sirmium in 508-510, when Theuderic, owner of the city since 504, returned the Pannonia Sirmiensis to Emperor Anastasius. Perhaps some gravers were sent from Ravenna, remember coin N1, or Milan, and once in Sirmium they were helped by local engravers less experienced, as evidenced by some dyes. This seems shown by some dye change that highlights the presence of a very different engraving abilities, as well as by the chain created between type 1 and type 2, which leads directly to the Ostrogothic coinage of Ravenna. The Sirmium group has a great uniformity, so it could have taken place from 505 or 510 to 527-528, about 20 years that could find evidences in stylistic chains in the group. The service would be interrupted when the minting of Justinian I coin already began, because of the agreement between the emperor and the Egyptians, in order to favor them in the recapture of Pannonia Sirmiensis, or perhaps when the Egyptians in 528 tried to regain the city of Sirmium after more than two decades. The coin 128B, that is type 3, known to me in two specimens from the same pair of dyes, having a reverse referring to Ethelric, even if it is possible it's simply a mutative coin, seems to be the last coin of this group. Its dating does not move to match the dating of the Sirmium group, as the coinage of this prototype in Italy occurred between 527 and 534. The dating of type 9 is very difficult, but anyway, the sequence which now seems to us more likely for the Sirmium group is the following. Coin N1, type 1 and type 4, whose sporadic minting, however, may continue for a long time. Type 2, then type 5, then type 6, then type 7 and type 8, perhaps partially together with type 3. And this coinage covers a period of about 20 or 25 years between 510 528, more or less. In this period, you can see the three emperors reported on the coins of the Sirmium group: Anastasius, Justin I, and Justinian I. It's in Italian, I'm sorry. The two Ostrogothic kings, Theuderic and Telleric, and the city of Sirmium in Ostrogothic hands in this period. And at present, no one coin can be assigned without doubt to the Egyptian king Colimo. Well, there is another mystery, as I told you before. If the type 3, it was a mystery, type 9, if possible, is some major cross in the central part, the two stars, and a bow in the sky. A bow that is mentioned in the Genesis 9:16. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth. And the surprises related to this coin, which I often found in recent months to call the God of the coins, are not over. In fact, by identity of reverse die, this coin is linked with two coins from excavation presented by Peter Koss in 1981. Here in the Koss coin, there is an epigraphic obverse that shows a facing bust, probably an angel, perhaps Saint Michael, Archangel, and in part because of this image, these coins were then identified as Lombard's quarter siliqua by Peter Koss. You can see the die link. The type of the coin presented by Koss leaves us unable to explain the enormous differences of obverse style in presence of an identical reverse die. The dating is very, very hard, and the obverse general style is totally different from the other coin die linked with R on 138. Many other coins appeared from excavation, mainly concentrated in today's Hungarian. Like this. The coin 175C, that is very similar to 175D, shows a specular reverse design that seems a voluntary choice of the engraver and not an intrinsic error. This feature was found in some imitating hexagrams from and ceremonial clearances that seems probably made by the errors, and that is that I will discuss in a upcoming paper. But in a period that is usually conceived with the reign of Constant II in the half of the 7th century. The requisition that seems a solved problem with the coin 175 is reopened looking to the coin 175D and B. The coin 175D with a correctly oriented grab shows once again the C on the left, that probably could even be another simplified monogram of Theodoric. And again, one of the two coins published by Koss in 1981, the two coins are from the same couple of dies, as a whole, probably for a non-monetary reuse. This whole suggests that the reverse for a correct reading must be turned upside down, even if in this case the natural shape of the breads seems wrongly positioned. The non-monetary reuse could happen many years after the minting, and for this reason this orientation must be considered a pure possibility. These particular issues, the type 3 and the type 9, could perhaps have been special and commemorative issues, perhaps this time to special donatives, or attempts to a stylistic innovation then rejected by the market. The truth about these specimens escape us, and at present it does not seem possible to speculate on study basis. The majority of the gold of the coins comes from graves whose dating stands between the first half of the 5th century and the second half of the 6th century. In many cases, the coins are pierced, probably for an ornamental use, admitting that this coin could have ever been a real monetary use. The Golgotha coins are a real mystery, both for dating and for obverse styles so different from the other coins of the group. Here you can see some significantly die links that may help in understanding the sequence and the dating. In this first example, we note the passage from that leads to the disappearance of the dotted circular red, at first on the reverse, and then on the reverse. There is a coexistence of verticalized and irregular pendants on the diadem, and the coexistence of three conceptually very different monograms, and the legend Roma and Ruma affinities between type 2 and type 5. Anastasius and Justin the First. How not appreciate in this case the link between regular and retrograde monograms, correct and imitative legends? These are direct dynamics. And here again, all these ones are direct dynamics. Here you can see the affinities between type 1 and type 2, apart from coin N1. Look just for example to the neck, or to the pendants of the dedan, or to the monogram, and many other details. Type 1, unique Victoria, type 2, unique Victoria. Here you can see once again the affinities between type 2 and Anastasius, and type 5, Justin First. There are affinities between type 5, type 6 in the name of Justin the First, type 7 and type 8 in the name of Justinian the First. Type 7 and type 8, as I told, are even dilinked by a first die. These examples seem really to force us to shorten the period of minting of the Sirmium group. In conclusion, even if at present nothing is sure about the Sirmium group, the official words are virtually totally unknown and unrecorded, the numismatic evidences, the die links, and the statistic similarities of the group compared to the historical facts leads us to assume that this group is linked by a certain continuity, and so the meeting should not have covered a long period of time. The comparative evaluation between numismatic evidences and historical facts seem to force us to give priority to the hypothesis that the old Sirmium group was minted by the Ostrogoths, probably in Sirmium, in a period that appears to cover the years from 504, 505 to 528-29, and more probably, as mentioned, a shorter period from 508-10 to 527-28. Even if many coins were for sure imitative or made by the bed engravers, like this one, everything seems to lead us to avoid the term gibbet quarter siliqua in favor of Ostrogothic quarter siliqua minted during the temporary possession of the city of Sirmium. The Sirmium group is therefore most probably to be fully assigned to the Ostrogothic coin age. I would like to thank again you for your attention. Thanks again to Professor Bush and Warsaw University for giving me this opportunity. Thank you again. This is Parma, my name is